Well, it looks like you're the one who needs to be taught a lesson, pal. Class is paying 101. Your instructor's Casey Jones.
Look, I don't want to fight you.
Well, tough rocks, pal.
It's a cup of coffee in the big time, yeah. Cup of coffee in the big time.
Hey, what do you say we both be independent together, huh?
All right, we have the tools, we have the talent. It's Miller time.
I said, empty your mind. Be formless, shapeless, like water. Now, you put water into a cup, it becomes the cup. You put water into a bottle, it becomes the bottle. You put it in a teapot, it becomes the teapot. Now, water can flow or it can crash. Be water, my friend.
The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is gonna hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. How much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, if you know what you're worth, then go out and get what you're worth. But you gotta be willing to take the hits. And not pointing fingers saying you ain't where you want to be because of him or her or anybody. Cowards do that, and that ain't you. You're better than that.
Well, that's great. Either I have a monster in my kitchen or I'm completely crazy.
I don't think you're crazy.
You know something? Maybe I am insane. Maybe I am insane.
You know what you need? You need a Brazilian plastic surgeon.
I've got one that can see.
It's showtime.
All right. Hello, everybody. How's it going? Welcome to Comic Book Radio. Thank you for being here. I'm your host, Peter Cimetti. This is episode 182, and tonight my guests, plural. I got to change that thumbnail. You got Bill Mouse and Steve Stern. Talking about Zen Intergalactic Ninja, among a host of other things. It's going to be a good one. Thank you guys for being here. I want to say hello to those of you in the chat before we bring both of them on. We've got Creators Outlet here. What's up, Creators Outlet? Hope you're doing good. Spicer McLeroy's in the house. What's up, Spicer? Thank you for being here. We got Bill Mouse also in the chat. We got Land Strider here. How's it going, Land Strider? Says, best of luck on your projects. Very nice. I like that. I like kindness and positivity being projected out there. It's good stuff. Now, before I do bring these two gentlemen on, I want to give you guys a reminder. I've got it pinned to the top of the chat. If you would like, we have Comic Book Radio stickers. These are about 3x3. This is the logo of the show. I'm signing the brim of the hat. You can get these on the alternatecomics.com site. It's $3 there too. But you also have to pay shipping. You know, you can put it with your order. It's flat shipping on the Alterna site. But for Comic Book Radio listeners only, if you guys go to that pinned post, comment, whatever you want to call it. I was going to call it a tweet for a second. It's not a tweet. At the top of the chat, you'll find a PayPal link. Just $3 free shipping worldwide. So don't add the shipping. Doesn't matter if you're not in the US. $3 free shipping worldwide. I'll send the sticker signed. And I will not sign the ones on the Alterna site. I'll just be signing the ones for you guys. So that goes right to PayPal. That's my personal PayPal. Make sure you put your address in there and I'll get those shipped out. All right. Before we bring on these two, I also want to say... The Granite Beast figure. That big dude. 7 inches. We've got resin figures of the King Cryptid characters. King Cryptid is a 3-inch figure. Behemoth's a 4-inch figure. Granite Beast is a 7-inch figure. These are 1 to 30 scale. The pre-order period for that ends March 31st. Also March 31st, and I'm going to be doing a dedicated show on the Alterna channel on the 30th. March 31st would be the last day to get these. April 1st, they won't be up. Also on March 31st, that's the last day to book advertising for King Cryptid 5 to 9 and also Blood Realm 14. It came out on Wednesday 21, Unit 44 9 and Unit 44 10. You can get Blood Realm advertising for 15 and 18, well, 15 to 18 right now, that new campaign that Rob Geronimo has going on. That's available with a 20% discount right now. Go check out alternacomics.com/advertising. Make sure you do not miss out. And hey, Hank, what's up? Thank you for being here. All right, so without further ado, give a big Comic Book Radio welcome. And I got to adjust the banner there. To Mr. Bill Mouse and Steve Stern, what's up?
Hey, how are you, Peter?
Good, how are you?
Thank you for calling us gentlemen. That was very kindly of you.
No problem. I always assume the best.
Nice evening to be on the
show. Until proven otherwise.
When I saw your banner for Comic Book Radio, for some strange reason, it reminded me of this song, Mexican Radio.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know if you're familiar with it.
Syllabically the same.
Yeah. Now, I think the name of the group that did that tune was The Tubes. I could be wrong, but I'll tell you what I'm not wrong about. The guy who was the leader of that group, and perhaps he was a one-man group, had this really unique name, and it's etched in my mind. You ready for it? Fee Waybill. That name ring any bells? Fee Waybill. How can you forget that name? That's got to be a stage name, right?
Yeah, yeah. I don't know, though.
Fee
Maybe not.
Waybill. Yeah.
You're going to force me to get on
the Google
machine.
I'm going to have to look that up.
I know. Right?
I'm going to have to look that up.
Yeah,
that's I don't know, Mexican radio.
You know what else I want to say, Peter? This is the first time we're meeting electronically or otherwise. And I did want to say to you and your audience that I've always been very impressed with what you've done. You made a power move by bringing out a line of comics in a form that people hadn't seen in a long time, kind of like hearkening back to comics of yore, right? With your like newsprint type look and the beautiful coloration of it. So kudos to you. You're a guy with foresight and a lot of entrepreneurial ability. So you deserve a little praise on your own show.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
It's the truth.
You know, there's about 90% lunacy in there, 10% creativity. You know?
Ain't that the truth for all of us, though?
Well, that's the formula. That's the formula. If you know
that's
the ingredients.
That's the formula.
100% obsession, you know? And then, yeah. You need that, especially in a creative field like comics.
Yes.
Now, I really want to know with you guys, and feel free to jump in whenever you want. I don't want to, like, call on people here. This isn't, like, comic book class. But for you guys, how did you get into comics in particular? Not creating, but into comics in general as readers.
All right. Now, you know, Bill has suffered through me waxing prolific on many shows over the years. My problem is I've been doing this so damn long that I could both of you guys could not say another word and I would absorb all the time on the show. Now, that ain't going to happen, but I had a forewarned Bill, because this is what happens when people, you know, press play on me. So forgive me a little bit, okay? So, Bill, how about you start and talk about how you got into comics, and then I'll pull up the other side.
Yeah, he'll nudge the quiet Puerto Rican to talk first. That's what he's going to do. No, I mean, getting into comics was something I got into as a kid. I think most people got into it when they were kids. My parents were Navy parents. I used to get dragged to the commissary or the Navy exchange, and I would be the most bored kid in the world while they were doing their shopping. And I would spend all of my time at their little newsstand area where all the magazines were. And that's where all the Spider-Man comics were, and that's where all my crack magazines were at. And crack magazine actually got me into it got me into wanting to try to do sequential work. That was the thing that got me into sequential art, only because John Severin was an artist on Crack Magazine during those years, and he was doing parodies of all of the shows that I happened to be watching at the time. So he hooked me, like, instantly. All the Knight Rider parodies, all the Fall Guy and A-Team, Greatest American Hero, all that stuff from that kind of 80s era. So had me hooked into that, and I got hooked into Spider-Man, and and it went from there. That's what, you know, childhood Bill got into comics.
You still have any of those issues from when you were a kid?
I've got a few, yeah. And I think one that I treasure, other than those big Star Wars treasury books, you know, I still got my original ones from back then. I've got this Spider-Man Beast team-up comic that's like I always look back on that one. It's wrinkled up. It's a mess, but it's like, yeah, I love that book.
Well loved.
Yeah, you know, it's like, it's one of those things. And then the Crack magazines, I've had to kind of rebuy those over the years just so I can have like a little set from the ones that I remember, you know, because there was a portion of those that were, those are the ones that stand out to me, and not really much of the other stuff, just because, you know, the age that it hit me and the artist that happened to be drawing it at the time. I'm actually lucky. I've got a John Severin original up on the wall.
Oh, and, wow.
Yeah, he really inspired me a lot, and I'm only sad that I never actually got the chance to meet him before he passed. I got to meet a lot of my other artistic comic book heroes along the way, you know, all the years doing shows and everything like that. We've been doing this since 91.
Man, yeah.
So I've been doing it for a minute. So I've been lucky enough to meet most everybody else that I would like to meet, you know, from those childhood experiences. But he was one that he'll forever remain, you know.
Yeah.
Very nice. You know, you never forget your first, right?
You know, his wife,
right? So yeah.
His wife Marie Severin, also a supremely talented artist.
Oh, yeah,
She just passed a couple of weeks ago.
So
it's funny, I'm familiar with both of them, and I don't think I ever made the connection that they were together.
Right. Yeah. Well, at first I never made the connection that there were two separate people drawing some of those strips and drawing some of the gags.
Wow.
So that was, they forever remain legend for me. So it's like, I don't have a tangible experience that, you know, having met them or anything like that. So that's, they remain legendary status for me in that way. So
yeah. It's nice to have that. Steve, what about you? How did you get into comics?
Okay, here we go. So
now this is an hour long show, Steve.
I'm gonna be concise. I'm visiting my maternal grandmother in the Bronx with my parents. I'm 7 years old. There's this thing called the L. It's the elevated train. Okay, underneath the L, they always had newsstands. So my parents figured they got to occupy me because I was getting kind of fidgety, whatever. So they bought this thing for a dime called a comic book for me. I'd never seen one. It was Superboy. I opened the thing up and love at first sight occurred. Either that or an embolism happened in my head, okay? And I fell in love with the four-color spandex-clad Superboy who I instantaneously identified with, right? So that happened when I was 7. Now go like 6 decades later, and this is what I do for a living, and I've been doing it for a long time. So to do what you love and what impacted you in such a forceful, you know, primal way as a kid, it's a blessing. And just to quickly talk about meeting, and in my case, working with somebody who I idolized, one of the books I read growing up that I loved because it was so different, so unique, was Metal Men. Guy named Robert Kaniger wrote it, created it, but the art was created by none other than Ross Andrew. Okay. And when we did the Zen Archie series run, okay, Zen had 6 issues put out through the Archie company. Archie calls me up one day and says, Ross Andrew would like to illustrate this, your stories. I said, what? And we met at a diner on Long Island. He and his inking partner, Mike Esposito, Andrew and Esposito, I sat across from them in a diner talking about how they were going to illustrate my character and my story for Archie Comics. So how do you think that affected me?
Oh, because, wow.
That's a good amazing story. Steve, that's a story I haven't heard. Yeah, 30 years working with this man. I finally get some new stories.
Not only that, but Ross and I became great friends. His wife was ill. My wife was ill. They both passed. I was the last person to talk to Ross before he passed away. And wow. I spoke at his funeral. But to have the opportunity to work with one of your childhood idols on your creation, I mean, it just does not get any better than that.
Yeah, that's absolutely that's good stuff. Yeah.
Do you happen to remember the diner, the name? I grew up on Long Island, so I might have been there. I might have been in that
Golden
diner at one point.
Golden Mermaid, maybe? Golden Mermaid? I grew up on... Where did you grow up on Long Island?
Levittown.
Lawrence.
Oh, okay. Okay.
You know, there's a lot of Long Island happening. We were talking,
I'm noticing this.
We were talking with Billy Tucci the other night, right?
Yeah. He's on Long Island, too.
He's from Long Island, too. So it's like, you know, there's something in the water, man.
Oh, there's all kinds of things in the water on Long Island, that's for sure.
I'm always
in New Hampshire now, but I grew up there. I was born in Brooklyn, and then when my family, we moved out to Levittown, I'd say when I was like 5 or 6.
Uh-huh. Wow.
And then I moved out of New York, let me see, maybe 15 or so years ago.
Mm-hmm.
That's funny. I was born in Queens. I lived in Queens until I was probably 8, and then my parents are Navy family, so we ended up moving around after that. But it's funny. It's like New York is the coffee filter of the comic book industry.
Well, I grew up in Lawrence, right? After my dad passed due to an accident type thing, my mom and I moved to Miami Beach. I grew up on my teenage years, high school and then college in Miami. And from there, I went to New Jersey and then back to New York. And then I lived in Maine for a couple of years. I lived in London for a year. And now I'm in Beverly Hills. But I've been in the L.A. area combinedly for like 20 years. So I've been all over the damn place.
You are. Yeah. I miss the West Coast.
You're a man of the world.
Well, maybe.
his home is Earth.
The Earth, yeah.
He lives on the Earth.
Bill, where are you right now? You don't have to give any specificity to your location, but
No, my exact coordinates are, in case you wanted to. I'm in Virginia Beach, Virginia, right now.
Oh, okay.
I did live in San Diego. When I first got into comics, I lived in San Diego for about 10 or 12 years, and that was like probably 3, maybe 4 lifetimes ago. I think in 2000, I ended up moving back to Virginia Beach. I kind of went through a page-turning event for myself, so became a single dad. My daughter was like 2 years old. I needed to go back where I had some support, and the cost of living wasn't so high. So Virginia Beach was home again, and that's where I've been since, you know.
Very nice. Well, speaking of living multiple lifetimes, let's get to one of those previous lifetimes when you were just starting off in your comic career. What was that like?
Way back.
Yeah.
I know, right? Steve, you want to go first? You want me to go
first?
Right?
Well, you know, I love comics. And I started writing and trying to draw them. Couldn't draw to save my life, but I had just enough talent to write, okay? Mm-hmm. So I started submitting stories. And my first two stories that were published were in these black and white horror magazines, Psycho and Nightmare. They were published by a company called Skywald. And then I did stories in Witch's Tales, which was countrywide publication. But I'll tell you a couple of interesting things. With Skywald, what they would do is they'd ask you to send in a brief synopsis of your story. Then artists who lived in the New York area, because they were based in Manhattan, would come into their office. This is long before the internet and everything, right? The artists would come into the office and read the synopses. And then if they liked them, you would get greenlit to do the story. The first guy who selected a story of mine was a guy named Jeff Jones. Now, this guy, he had a strip in the back of the National Lampoon called Idle, or E-I-D-Y-L. And astonishing artist. So the very first artist that did a story of mine was Jeff Jones. He later changed his sex. He was one of the first people in the comics industry transgender.
Oh, wow.
And he passed. Mm-hmm. He passed.
Around what year was that?
This is like mid to late 70s.
Okay.
Gotcha.
And then the second guy to select a story of mine was a guy named Michael William Kaluta. Mike Kaluta. So the second story I had published was by Kaluta. So I was lucky, you know, I was lucky. Mm-hmm. And then after that, many years went by when I was not in the comic book industry. I owned an advertising agency in Princeton, New Jersey. Had some decent sized clients. That's what my background was, advertising, right? But eventually I met a guy named Dan Cody, who was the son of the folks who owned Cody's Old Fashioned Ice Cream in Auburn, Maine. Now that sounds kind of funky, right? But Yankee Magazine, which is the arbiter of all things cool in New England, called Cody's Old Fashioned Ice Cream, and I quote, "the best damned ice cream in New England." So this was serious ice cream. And when I went to the office of Nancy Cody and I saw these fabulous pen and ink drawings festooned on the walls, I said, "Who did those?" She said, "My son, Dan." And she said, "You know, Steve," she said, "Steve, if Dan becomes the artist on our newspaper ads and stuff, I'll give you the account." So not being stupid, I instantaneously said yes. But I love this art anyway. I go and I meet Dan. He's airbrushing stuff up in the attic in his home in Lewiston, Maine. And I tell him I've done comics in the past. I'd love to work on a comic book. He said, "Steve, I've always, my whole life, wanted to work on a comic book. But my parents wouldn't let me read comics when I was a kid. They thought it was like the devil's work, right?" So now he's an adult. He was a father. He had a kid. So we created this little book called Zen. And we'll talk a lot about that later.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
It's always great hearing the origin stories.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah.
Man. I lived out, when I first moved from Virginia Beach to San Diego, like I said, I was when I first moved out there, I just graduated a art community college kind of thing over here. I was always, I never really took art in high school or anything like that. So when I went to art community college, I was like, oh, you know what? This is really, because I was just getting in trouble the rest of the time. I really was drawing when I wasn't supposed to the rest of the whole time since elementary school. That was just it was a trouble card. But
you had a calling.
Apparently the thug life chose me or whatever. So I guess I had no choice and I wasn't really qualified to do anything else. It was either that or be a really professional tuba player in an orchestra at some point, because that was the only other thing I was doing. So I could have ridden for free at Duke University. They offered me a spot because I was actually quite good. I had a
diaphragm. For tuba?
Yeah, for tuba. Yeah.
Never knew this, Bill. I'm hearing this for the first time.
Yeah. Well, I was on the kind of career track I would have been on would have been like, you know, like the type of orchestras that play like movie soundtracks for like Game of Thrones or like for television and movies, and I would have been one of those working musicians. Not a lot of tuba players in that industry, and their parts are always way easier than everybody else's. I would have killed, dude. It would have been awesome. But I decided, like, comic books is my first love. That's always what I've always drawn, comic strips as a kid and whatever. So when I went to college, I took fine art, I took commercial. I actually got my associate's in commercial media advertising arts because they don't have a degree for comic book people. And I took a lot of broadcasting courses, filmmaking, photography, all that. Anything. Those are the types of things that I'm interested in.
Yeah.
So after I graduated, my dad got transferred to San Diego. And I'm like, whoa, like that's an opportunity. In my mind, that's a huge opportunity for me because that's where people go to become movie stars and artists and actors and whatever. So I just decided when I moved to San Diego that whatever job I got involved in was going to be something art related. Try to climb the ladder, try to find my spot, try to find my place. I worked a lot of different jobs. I worked at an animation studio working on Attack of the Killer Tomatoes for Saturday morning TV.
No way.
Yeah, I worked on Mamato.
Love that show.
Oh my god, it's like Mamato is my nightmare, but also like a good experience. It was really cool experience. And working with other animators that worked on other really popular shows, that was really cool just to be involved in that. But I also worked at SeaWorld drawing caricatures. That was like my boot camp for art. So I sucked for like 6 months. It's like just putting yourself out there every day and getting an instant response from people in 5 minutes, whether or not you were good or not. So you're really putting yourself out there. So I did that for about 3 years. And there's a friend of mine who worked with me. His name's Bob Hannon. And Bob and I used to talk all the time about comics, about this and that. You know, we just love drawing and comics and stories and this and that. He would brag to me every now and then. He knew an editor. Oh, yeah, I was back then. He likes the name drop a lot. And it wasn't necessarily for myself, but I kind of elbow him a lot. It's like, well, you know this editor. Call up that, prove it to me. Prove it to me because you keep on talking about it, but I don't see nothing happening. So eventually I nudged him enough that he did get in contact with that editor, and he did get a job, and he got this gig, and it was for a book called X-Farce from Eclipse Comics. The book, when he got the gig, I don't know what it was. I don't know what was happening with that book before he got that gig, but they gave him this impossible deadline of like a week and a half. Literally a week and a half
to do the whole book?
To do the whole book.
Yeah.
So I ended up benefiting from, I was just happy that he got the job. You know, I thought I was going to go to Comic-Con and show my portfolio and eventually, you know, get somebody's attention. So what happened was I ended up being the penciler. Out of the two of us, I'm very fast at penciling. He's a lot faster at inking. So we just turned it into this marathon. And we had a script written by Don Chin. This is where I met Don Chin for the very first time.
Oh.
So that's how the three of us, we had like the three amigos there for a little while in the 90s. So we turned out that book. It was supposed to have, according to them, it was supposed to have a Todd McFarlane cover. And I was like, really? My first gig is going to have a Todd cover? Are you kidding me? That's crazy. It ended up not having a Todd McFarlane cover. It ended up having our cover, which is fine. I think it's
they dangled that carrot so you get that done in a week.
They did. Oh my god, they did. So that was hardcore. That was rough. I think the book ended up selling 80 or maybe 100,000 copies or something like that. I have to ask Don to be positive again.
Wow.
But did that really was well. That was like put us in the blast furnace, you know, for a first job, no pressure, you know, trying to get it done and then and getting it but luckily because we had that experience and we met each other, Don gave me a call soon after. We did like two or three issues for Eclipse. And Don gave me a call and told me about his idea for starting Parody Press. So we actually co-founded Parody Press together. We both moved to Virginia so that way our studios would be closer to each other so we can get work done a little bit more efficiently. And we co-founded Entity Comics. And then when we co-founded Entity Comics, Don met Steve and Dan and talked about maybe publishing Zen. And Zen was our very first title that we published under the Entity Comics banner. And yeah. And that's how we all got together. It's a crazy decade.
Wow.
Yeah.
Of being at the right place at the right time and and being available and just carving it out, just making it happen and making it work.
Yeah, it was an amazing time. It was.
When's the last time that that there was a new Zen comic?
Oh, very okay. Well, you know, a lot of people are unaware of the fact that Zen has pretty much been published continuously over the 37-year history. We've been with First Comics since 2011. A lot of people don't even know that First Comics came back in 2011.
Hmm.
But in around 2017, 18, we did a series that I wrote and Marat Michaels illustrated called Hard Bounty, because Zen's a bounty hunter. We'll talk about that a little bit later. Okay, so we put out 6 issues of Hard Bounty. It was a 6-issue series, and pretty much all the issues sold out. Then First Comics issued a trade paperback, the first printing of a trade paperback of that, and that sold out right away. Then they did a second printing of the Hard Bounty trade paperback, and that sold out. And the last time I saw an issue of it anywhere on the web, it was on Amazon, and somebody was selling one issue of that trade paperback for $150, and they sold it. Okay.
Wow.
So people, you know, the people who have been dyed-in-the-wool Zen fans for so many decades, they know all this stuff, right? This is like second nature to them. But a lot of people, perhaps including yourself, you know, you can't know everything about everything, right? Like, do you know, for example, Peter, that there were 2 Konami video games of Zen?
I do.
Okay. So, see, you may or may not have known that. Some people know, right? There was an 8-bit NES game, which was
a Game Boy game and an NES game, right?
Yep.
Absolutely. Yep. And if you go to eBay right now, right, and you look, you will see that one copy of that NES cartridge is selling for $4,500.
Now, Steve, wasn't the NES game, it has the distinction of being the very last game that they
of the
made
8-bit.
Of the 8-bit games?
Yep.
So that was the end of the 8-bit gaming history.
Yes. And it's kind of considered like the cool. best 8-bit game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Interesting that it ends on a Z word.
Yeah. They wanted to stay alphabetical.
Yeah.
So then, Peter, you probably also know there was a line of Just Toys action figures that, or maybe you didn't know, I don't know. And that they related to the video games. And the third element that these all three related was the Archie series, okay? Because that was the comics, the video games, and the action figures. Mm-hmm. They all linked together, and it was very, very, very successful for us. I dare say if those things hadn't happened, I would not be talking with you today. I would not be here. I'd be faded away back doing just advertising or something, right? But we had a lot of luck, you know. I mean, obviously, I think the creativity people like Bill and I and Marat Michaels and L'Amour Supreme put into Zen, you know, pays off. Because we're damn serious about the comic books we do. You can't have a book that's been alive for 37 years, sold a good few million copies, and had all this licensing. That just can't be like a total fluke, you know?
No, yeah, not at all. This, as you guys know, this business in particular, especially when you're independent, if you're just going to go, all right, I did it, you know, you put your feet up, and you're like, it'll take care of itself. It'll find right. its audience, you know? And they'll discover it, and I made the book. The book will sell itself.
Yeah, right.
I've talked to a lot of people over the years with that attitude. I'm like, that book's not going to sell itself.
Right.
It's a very strange, I don't know where that mentality comes from, but that never happens. That never happens. You got to have that drive, that perseverance, that consistency, that determination. Things aren't going to go your way a lot of the time. You got to bounce back from that.
Yeah, you can only do this
game plan.
Yeah, you can only do this if you love it, because it's a roller coaster, and we don't exactly have. I don't know if we ever did, but I felt like back in the 90s, at least it felt like there was a hub where you would know about everything. At least, you know, it's like you'd be a lot more aware. Where right now, I feel like we're, you know, there's like there's the Kickstarter, Indiegogo kind of world, and then there's direct market world, and then there's you're just different. There's like several different smaller hubs, and if you don't take the time out to visit everywhere, you kind of miss out on different things that are happening.
Kind of
wish there was just like this one hub where it's just like, okay, let's find out about everything and see what everybody's doing. But we'll have to see if that evolves.
We're in a new we're in a new world with social media, the internet, crowdfunding, you know, mm-hmm. but, you know, it's exciting, right? I mean, when you have to figure out how to keep, you know, like that great Rocky quote you have at the beginning of your show about, you know, you're going to get knocked down, but getting up, that's the key. Right?
I was too busy being the water. I'm trying to be the water. Damn it.
Yeah. Be like water. Yeah. The way of water.
Yeah. The intro hits you hard with those two.
Yeah. Back yeah. Sure but does. I like that though. I like that message. Cause ever since the very beginning, ever since before I did this for cold, hard cash, I've always done it to make friends. That's how I kind of connect with people. That's how I've been able to form friendships over these years, you know, since I was a kid. And I'm doing it now also. I mean, we have to monetize our time because we're adults and we all have bills. But luckily, this is still how I make friends. I wouldn't have met you today unless unless I had been drawing some stuff for a while, you know? So
yeah.
I actually have something to talk about.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing is, and you were talking about it earlier, Steve, in terms of being lucky enough to pursue something you really loved as a kid and then turn that into what you do with your life.
Yeah.
And you never know where this stuff is going to take you. That's why there's so many people out there where they're overthinking it so much about how do they approach it? How do they get started? What do they do? Yeah. They want to do this. They want to do that. They want to make sure that, you know, they're making the right impression here and there.
Mm-hmm.
But they're never thinking about just get started with your work.
Right.
And then get on that journey, and that's where it starts taking you. And then people, they build up rejection in their mind, thinking that that's the end-all, be-all. You know, oh, someone rejected you. So that means you're no good. You're never going to be any good. Yeah. You might as well give up. And that's just a no pointing it towards a yes, but you got to figure out what that yes is.
Right.
And if you give up, that's on you. That's not on them.
No,
that's on you. You got to keep pursuing it.
You know, this has to do with the fact that when we say the comic book business, right? Okay, there's the creative end, which is making that cool book, right? But the other end is the business. And you know full well with Alterna Comics and what Bill and I have done. You know, the business part, if you have no savvy on the business end, that creative stuff is never going to probably see the light of day. And not everybody can do that, you know.
Yeah, I wear more hats nowadays than I really signed up for.
Right.
You know, it's like, because, you know, I think we're doing everything except driving the comics in trucks to the collector at this point. But at the same time, I'm grateful that we get to deal directly with the fans, with collectors, with people that are actually, instead of having a couple of steps in between, is like that little bit of a disconnect. I like being able to be connected directly to people and hearing their ideas. And I see that they like the fact that their ideas being shot back at me actually has an effect on what I do.
Yeah.
You know, some of their ideas make it into the books and changes my style. It changes my approach. I mean, I'm drawing, I draw for myself. You know, everybody creatively does what they love to do for themselves, but I'm really doing it. Not everybody should do this, but I do it to please others, because that's, like I said, that's how I make friends. I want to show it to somebody and be like, ah, what do you think? You think this is cool? You know, it's like, that's like the little kid in me is still doing that.
Well, you got to find that angle that works for you.
Right.
You know, that gives you a reason to keep on doing this, you know?
Exactly. And if I get that response from people, that's kind of my high. It's like, oh, do you think this is cool? And if they think it's cool, I'm just like, yes. Then I go do more. You know, it's like, I feel fed.
Yeah. I
feel energized by it, you know.
Absolutely. Yeah, I've always loved when fans, we used to reprint a lot of letters in the Zen Comics, either the ones that Dan and I self-published under the Zen Comics banner or the Entity banner or Archie books. All of those books had letters from the fans, you know, and I took them really seriously and took them to heart. But the greatest rush is when you're affecting people and they like what you're doing. You know, they actually want to follow you. They
That's what I don't understand about some, I won't name the companies because everybody will know what I'm talking about. It's like certain movie companies right now are literally not only not listening to the fans, but they're kind of blaming the fans or telling the fans to be quiet, just like what we do. You know, that sort of mentality.
Yeah, yeah.
Which you can make whatever you want. That's totally cool. But don't insult the fans for simply responding to, you know, they're just responding on threads, and they're responding online in places that are designed to express your opinion about a certain topic or a certain movie or a certain character or whatever. That's not them being, you know, bad necessarily. They're just responding to what you're making. You know, it's like,
at the core of it, the entertainment industry is a service industry.
Right.
It's all about serving people. You know, instead of serving them food and you give them a good meal that nourishes them physically, you give them a good story. You give them something that nourishes their soul, nourishes their mind. You know, so and there's many different ways to provide something like that.
Sure.
So if you don't view it as that, though, and it's you view it as they're there to serve you.
Right. They're sort of they sort of make me feel like I owe them something. And I'm just like, this isn't a relationship where you're the parent scolding me for not liking the movie. This is a relationship where you're trying to date the audience. You're trying to woo the audience, saying, hey, look, I made something just for you. And I don't know. I like to listen to the fans. I like to listen. That's what feeds me, actually, is knowing that they're happy with what I'm doing, or thinking that it's cool, or thinking that it's funny. That's what kind of gives me the energy to keep doing it.
What's so confusing to me about the whole thing on that subject is the fact that everyone likes something different. I know people that hate, like, Lord of the Rings.
Right,
or,
right.
You know, they can't stand something that someone, that everyone seems to love.
Yeah.
You know, I know people who hate pizza.
Right. But that's normal. Yeah, right?
There's no accounting for taste, you know? So when you go into it and you create something, if people don't like it, they don't like it. Okay. And if people do like it, they like it. You know, it's.
Right.
So I don't understand the knee-jerk reaction to demonize or castigate an individual or an audience or whoever it may be, especially when it happens to be on social media, which is basically just everyone going, okay, I'm going to express my opinion about something.
Right.
You know, and then someone goes, okay, well, I'm going to express my opinion back. All right. You know, you want to have a discussion, you want to have some kind of conversation about it, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But when you're the artist, the studio, the whatever it is that's creating it, and you start to interject and tell them no, they're bad for not liking this.
They're wrong for not liking it. I know, right?
It's can't like, wrap my head around that.
Right. I don't understand that. It seems self-destructive.
Remember,
I don't get it.
About some monolithic companies, you know, we know the companies we're talking about, right? These are huge global companies, right? They hire people. They hire executives who either green light or do not green light projects. So, you know, it's a huge organization paying huge bucks to tons of people who end up having to make these corporate decisions. And of course, that's a recipe for disaster.
Yeah, too many cooks in a kitchen is bad. And sometimes producers are maybe disconnected from what the audience thinks it's cool. You never know. You know, I mean, there's so many different combinations of things that can. But listening to an audience, I think, is just so key. It's just
that's what I love so much about the indie experience, though.
Mm-hmm.
Is you cut out all the varieties of middlemen in a way.
Yeah, right.
Sometimes literally, you're cutting them out of the equation. Mm-hmm. And you get that direct pipeline to the audience.
Yeah.
And, you know, as long as you've got the proper mindset to understand that, yes, you should not live and die by the praise and the criticism, by the people who love it, the people who hate it. There's going to be people who irrationally love it and irrationally hate it. And that's the way it is. You know, and you keep making your thing and you keep putting it out there. And hopefully you keep focusing on what it is that it means something to you. And hopefully what means something to the people that it resonates with. But that's the path forward. You know, getting distracted by everything else, that's a recipe for failure.
Kind of a Jerry Springer situation. Yeah, I don't want to get...
Yeah.
I'm a non-drama person, so I...
I try to be, man, but it finds me. And I'm trying nowadays to just be like, all right, you found me. Good for you. and just keep walking along. Yep, you got me. Here I am. Okay, you have a good one.
Like, you're good. You got the Teflon. It's fine.
Man. We got some great questions in the chat. Before we dive deeper into Zen Intergalactic Ninja, I want to get to these. Let's see. And some of them have to do with Zen. So they never read Zen, but had always seen it here and there. How do you feel indie comics have evolved since you began to now?
Wow. Yeah. Well, most indie comics have a very short lifespan. Okay. Mm-hmm. They come and they go. Because of a lot of the reasons you were talking about, Peter, after one, two, or maybe three issues, the people who started it don't have the business acumen or the creative wherewithal to keep going with it, right? So I've seen so many scores and hundreds of my fellow indie comics come and go over the decades, right? Because we're talking decades, right?
Yeah. So
all I can say is the ones that survive, the ones that are still around, there's some magic that happens. Yes, you need the creativity, but you need primarily a character or characters who are charismatic that people care about. Okay.
Absolutely.
And you need storytelling that's compelling, right? It's the same thing in the movie industry. You need compelling characters and storylines, right? And on top of that, you have to have the marketing acumen, and you have to have all the business acumen needed to run a publishing company like you also do, Peter, right? So the indie scene is like all over the place because very few books survive. Mm-hmm. And that's okay too. You know, some creators have one basic story to tell, and once they've told it, it's done. Okay? Other people have continual stories to tell, like Bill and I have been doing for over decades. So everybody's different. Nothing's better or worse than the other.
Right.
You know, everybody has some talent. But there's different levels of talent, and you know, Bill has superlative talent. He really does. I wouldn't be
When I first started. I think all my fans paid me to get better. I'm still working on it. I'm glad they're happy. I'm so happy that they're supporting me. But I think I transitioned from having fans or having the mentality of having fans to having friends that support me. You know what I mean? So. It's a never ending journey. I'm never going to think that I've got things figured out. I'm still waiting to get discovered. You'll see. I hit it some point.
You're pretty well discovered.
this is all good practice. 30 years.
Well, that answers the question, but that's the best way.
I mean, things obviously have changed. They're always changing.
Mm-hmm.
But
I think the access now is the biggest difference.
Everybody
has the access now to jump on Kickstarter or Indiegogo and put their work out there.
There's less excuses nowadays to say, oh, well, I can't get my stuff made.
Right. Exactly. Sit down, get it drawn, and throw it up on Kickstarter and just see what happens. See if it connects with people or not. Before, even though it was the indie scene back in the day, in the 90s, you had to have a lot of upfront money just to see the darn thing in your hand, you know, physically printed in your hands. Not to mention have some know-how, which I don't have that know-how, that 90s know-how. That was I'm very spoiled. Thank you, Don, for taking care of the publishing end of everything for like 10 years. You know, the whole deal of dealing with printers, dealing with distributors. We used to have 30 distributors when we first started out. You know, actually, we did a lot of shows. We made a lot of sales at four shops that didn't know who we were, simply because we would always do like the preview night that would be before the regular convention weekend at a given convention.
Oh, yeah.
And we would just have a great relationship meeting all of these retailers. And they're just like, oh, these guys seem like nice guys. I'll buy 5 books from you. It'll send you up the river. We'll see what happens.
Yeah.
You know, and it's a really different world in that sense, where it's like the kind of legwork and networking that you had to physically do back then, as opposed to what you're doing now, which is all digital legwork, digital networking. You know, it's like you can, you know, it's a different world in that sense. So two different angles. We presented two different sides of the dice.
Absolutely. Yeah, because we're still all just making comic books.
Exactly. Yeah. At it's the end of the day, that's what
how
we're
you
doing.
Getting out there, how you mm-hmm. reaching people. Right. That's definitely right. changed.
Yes.
Comics for Life, you got a couple of great questions here, but they kind of touch upon the conversation that we're going to be having about Zen right now. So as far as creating that character, how did that come about?
Okay, little story quickly. Remember I mentioned that with the Skywall Company, you'd put in a little synopsis, and if an artist sparked to it, you'd have a story done. So back in the 70s at some point, I had a one-page synopsis called Zen. No artist sparked to it. I take it with me. I put it in a suitcase, and it comes with me and my wife up to the state of Maine, where we relocate to. And a couple of days before I met Dan Cody through that advertising account, the thing cracked open, literally the suitcase fell, it cracked open, and out comes that one-page synopsis. That's the thing I presented to Dan after he told me he wanted to do
a
comic book. So that talk about, you know, serendipity, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, that's the universe tapping you back on the shoulder again.
I was doing a little interstellar thing. I was actually coming to you through my closet, like interstellar, and I made the briefcase fall. Because I wanted to get some, I needed work, and the only way I could get work in the future was to make sure he came up with Zen.
Right. And then there was the whole process of, you know, over the first few issues, creating Zen's total origin, right? Which, mm-hmm. you know, again, we can get into stuff to whatever extent you want or do not want to get into, but that's how that happened. It was totally serendipitous. And some things in life are just, I guess, meant to be, you know, and some ain't, you know.
In terms of making that character specifically, you know, the way you guys did it with an intergalactic ninja, what was the thought process behind that? Was the character always envisioned to be that, or did that kind of take place and evolve a bit because of the time?
Yeah, well, okay, the reason I called him Zen was I was always into the philosophy, not the religion, of Zen Buddhism, okay? I found it to be like the most intelligent, earth-based, practical, realistic philosophy, or if you want to call it a religion, but it's really Zen Buddhism is more like a philosophy. So I wanted to embody in a character the basic tenets of Zen. And that's really why I believe he appeals to so many people over so many decades. Zen's a thinking guy. He kind of operates in a thoughtful way, right? And he was raised by the mystic masters of Om on the planet Om, Master Sattva specifically, with whom he's always, over his whole career, communed with across the ether. He just has to sit down in his meditation chamber, and he gets advice and communication in the quote-unquote celestial garden of meditation that Master Sattva loves to call it. So in other words, this Zen is not just a butt-kicking, ass-kicking, ninjistic savant, right? He's a thoughtful guy who wonders about what his life is really about. He doesn't even know where he's from. He was created in a test tube. He was a test tube baby. He was an experiment that was deemed a failure, and this kindly female scientist who was working on it, named, of all things, Tesla, right? She was told to dispose of the biomatter, but he was alive, he lived, so she put him in a pod, like a waste pod, and jettisoned him out into space. And, you know, providentially, that pod fell into the gravitational pull of the planet Om, where it landed, and Zen was raised by these mystic masters. So that, you know, that origin alone is replete with heaviness, you know, like this guy is not just, you know, whatever. And so Zen was created to be a character who is like every man who's wondering about What's his destiny? You know, because after he was raised on Om and became the greatest acolyte of the Masters, they gave him this spaceship that had been left there by a previous person and said, go forth and find your destiny. We have no more to teach you. And so for Zen's entire career, he's always out there trying to find the meaning of his existence and where he came from.
That's great. I knew about Zen, I like the little, but that's a great summary description. It's like you've done this before, Steve.
Just a few hundred times. I've been doing conventions and store appearances since 1987. I've done virtually every convention you can think of. I went to Comic-Con when it was in a hotel in San Diego.
Oh, man.
So it's like, you know, it's just been amazing. And where have all the years gone? It's just, I just keep going with this. You know, it's just like, as long as people are reading and buying this comic, and knock on wood they are, I'm just going to keep doing it.
Yeah, it keeps us young, man.
Fantastic. Here's a great question for Comics for Life, which is a great follow-up. It says, what's the difference of the character now as opposed to when you started the series?
Well, okay, couple things. On a physical level, when Dan first drew Zen, Zen did not have a nose or a mouth. He just had eyes, you know, kind of an alien-ish thing, ET-looking thing. Well, I always wanted him to have a face, especially because it was really difficult to go over, like, how does he talk? He has to be telepathic. How does he eat? Telekinetic metabolization, I come up with that. You know, how does he eat? So I wanted him to be able to eat and talk and be kind of normal. But there's another reason, which I'm going to tell you, a very practical reason, why the face had to happen. Zen was optioned for films twice. When you get optioned, the production company gives you some option money and they get like 12 to 18 months exclusive ability to develop that as a movie, right? So in the two cases where Zen was optioned, and of course those movies didn't occur, which is great because it now gives us the opportunity to do it now, okay? But in those cases, actors started wanting to get attached to Zen. And I can say this, I can tell you, that Ron Perlman wanted to play Zen, Hellboy. That didn't happen for a lot of complex reasons, but one of the things Ron said to me right off the bat was, I want my face to be seen. So I understood that, and other actors, like, would you believe Steven Seagal? Okay. Other actors wanted to be Zen, right? And they all would say the same thing. And I had always wanted Zen to have a face, so around 1995, I don't know what year, I did a book with Bill called Zen Bounty Hunter. And that book, by the way, if people go to the First Comics website, they can buy that book if they want, right? That is the book that two major things happened in. One is Zen grew a face. I explain how it happened, okay? I won't get into it here. But the other thing that book did, that seminal book that Bill and I did, is it put Zen firmly in the bounty hunting genre, which I had always wanted to do because I'm a huge fan of the whole bounty hunting genre, going back to the Old West books, okay? Because that's where bounty hunting really started, right? So that's kind of a convoluted answer with a lot of ramifications, but if that doesn't say something about how Zen has changed, I don't think anything does.
That's a good answer. I don't think it was convoluted at all. I could follow that.
Good.
We followed along.
See, the problem is I've been living with this for so long. You do see what I'm saying. You ask me a question, I've got an answer. You know.
Oh, I hear you. I hear you. I know what that's like. Absolutely. Man. Thank you so much, Comics for Life. And you also had a question there, too, about film animation adaptation. So Steve kind of actually touched upon that during the course of explaining that question. And the same thing for you guys. If you've got questions, let us know. Put them in the chat. So with Zen right now on this campaign, I'm going to share it for a second here.
Okay.
cool.
Let's see. This is currently on Kickstarter.
Yeah.
The link is in the description of the show if you guys want to go check it out. So you got Zen Bounty Wars number one. Let me get this little doohickey out of the way here. There we are. So what can readers expect with this?
Okay, well, Bill, you or me? I mean, you know me. I'm talking here. I don't want to dominate this. Bill, why don't you talk
about it? Well, like all these story elements, this is all you, man. This is your showcase. You know, you're the writer.
Right. Okay, all right. So as quickly as I can.
I paint the pretty pictures.
Okay, this is my ultimate statement on what it means to be a bounty hunter, okay? At the beginning of the story, Zen has a really wild encounter with what is called a bounty killer. This is a real part of the bounty hunting profession. Bounty killers are guys who always kill their quarry, even if the contract is dead or alive. They're just cold-blooded killers, and the reason they get away with it is when they drag in the carcass, they always say to the authorities, "He tried to escape. He tried to kill me. I killed him in self-defense." Okay, this really kicks Zen off. It's not the first time he's encountered a bounty killer, but it makes him really begin to question his profession. So he goes in meditation. He communes with Master Sattva, who says, "Look, Zen, you've always been such a loner. Get to know some of your fellow bounty hunters before you make any kind of abrupt decision, and then you'll know." So Zen takes the message to heart, as he often does with Master Sattva's advice. He goes to a bounty hunting lodge, and we meet several other bounty hunters, okay? Which, you know, they all have their very distinct personalities. And during the course of that, there's a war that has broken out between two warring space lords who want to take over their sector of space. And Zen gets hired to bounty hunt the munitions dealer for one of the two space lords by the other space lord. What he and Nira X, who's also there and who's like a part-time bounty hunter, what they don't know is that now a full-scale bounty war is breaking out because both lords are hiring every bounty hunter they can get their hands on to decimate the other guy's troops, okay, or kill or take out the other lord. So hence the title Bounty Wars. And over the course of the four books, because this is book one of four, there'll be four Kickstarters.
Oh, okay.
Over the course of this, Zen and Nira get involved in the biggest adventure, bounty hunting adventure I've ever written. And I think it's full of interesting characters, excitement. Zen makes a decision by the end of the series, which we won't talk about what that is. But that's, you know, that's what it is. That's what Bounty Wars is about. And it's
very
the
nice.
It's the direct sequel to that hard bounty book that has sold out that Murat and I did. Yeah.
Yep.
Fantastic. So you've got the first cover here. The main cover is by Bill.
Mm-hmm,
yeah. You got that at 15. You got the wraparound cover at 20.
Uh-huh. And then we have the Cat Mouse cover. Cat Mouse is actually my daughter. She's been in the industry now for, gosh, I think 11 years.
Yeah.
Oh, fantastic.
She colors graphic novels. She does her own art. She's the 2.0. She's a sport model. She's coming up.
Oh, she's great. Yeah.
Yeah, I dig her cover. I like that style.
Yeah,
her style is very, very cool. I like it leans really heavy into like a manga, anime kind of style, and that's I really like how she's evolving, you know, her own.
Yeah, I think
work.
She's the future of Zen artists. I really do, and hopefully I'm going to be doing a project with her, very soon. Yeah, a Zen project, which mm-hmm. I'm writing right now.
Oh, yep, fantastic! Yep.
Yeah,
she done took my job, Pete.
You'll be okay, man. You'll be okay.
You were training your replacement all these years.
That's
you got
what I was doing all
blame.
This time. It's like, I guess I'll just be filling blacks from now on and getting the ink. And
you can become Cat's assistant.
There you go.
Let's see. True Believers asking, are there any trade paperback collections or plans for running?
Oh, my God. Yes. Okay. Well, once again, you know, I can start talking here and it never stops. Okay, so Pete, Were you aware that prior to this Kickstarter, we did another one? The Zen's first Kickstarter in 36 years?
Oh, no. No,
okay,
I wasn't aware.
So let me show you something, all right? We're talking about a trade paperback. Here's a little something. See this?
Oh, okay, let me full screen you on that. Look at that.
Okay, this is a hardcover edition of L'Amour Supreme's Zen. Okay, this was the first Kickstarter we did. It's totally gorgeous. I got to show you. Look at this guy's art. How's that for you?
Oh yeah, very nice.
So I have to.
gotcha.
Just like mind-blowing, right? Okay. So, okay, quick story. I'm walking through a mall on Long Island, of all places. I see at the end of a corridor this guy airbrushing T-shirts. And the work, like, blows my freaking mind, right? I get him to work on a 71-page story with me called The Rawhead Saga. This guy, whose real name is Joel Orbeta, but who christens himself L'Amour Supreme, stops doing comics and goes on to become a world-famous pop artist whose work has been displayed in Tokyo, Berlin, Stockholm, New York City in a major gallery. This is the only comic book stuff he ever did. It's a 71-page
story. No way. Wow.
And we did a Kickstarter on it. It was quite successful. And so this is a book. I don't know if First Comics is going to make it available, okay, beyond the Kickstarter. But that's one book that people should be on the lookout for, right? And then we've done other trade paperbacks. Well, like I said, the Hard Bounty.
Mm-hmm.
Hard Bounty.
I remember coloring those 70 pages.
Yeah, you did.
What year was that from?
That was from, gosh, was it 90? What was the exact?
Talking about? 95.
95, right.
Wow.
Yeah. This is the aforementioned Hard Bounty trade paperback.
Yeah, I think the question is probably thinking about if we're going to doing any new trade paperbacks coming up, like, say, from this series now, series.
Yeah.
You'll gather that once the four issues are out.
Right.
And here's the book that Bill and I did that I referred to. This is Zen Bounty Hunter, okay?
Yep.
And this is so. And yes, we'll no doubt do a trade paper. We'll collect the 100-page story into a trade paperback after all four issues have, you know, been kickstarted. Yeah.
Fantastic.
I hope that explains a little, you know.
Yeah.
Definitely got
a lot of
irons in the fire. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. See, True Believer says that they had backed the Kickstarter, so now you got 98 backers on there.
Thanks so much.
Thank you so much.
There you go. Perfect. Two away from 100.
SDA is asking if there's going to be any Zen classic trades, like the old original Dan Cody Zens. Are we going to see if those collected up?
There's a book you could get at firstcomics.com, and First Comics is the number one. firstcomics.com. If you go there and they have a full like Shopify thing where you can buy this Bounty Hunter, and there's also a book there called The Best of Zen, which is an archival book which has the Archie stuff in it. It has the very first story Dan and I did. So yeah, that's available at First Comics.
Wow. Is Dan involved in any capacity at all anymore?
Well, yeah, Dan did his own. Dan can also, like Bill, he can also write as well as illustrate. And Dan did his own graphic novel called The Zenith Orb, okay? It's very different than what I do, you know, because we're two different people, okay? And The Zenith Orb is also at firstcomics.com. So there's a lot of... If people want to get into Zen, you know, obviously this book Bounty Wars is to me the best thing I've ever done, because the next thing I do is always the best. You know, it's got to be. If it isn't, there's something wrong with it, right?
Well, yeah, so especially if it's worse than the things you've done previously, then why are you doing it?
Exactly. Well, I'm working with Bill, so I got this here mediocre story I got to get out.
Yeah, but I would say that anyone interested in Zen, whether they're new to him or been around for a long time, they got to get Bounty Wars, because it's just the coolest, most complex, most bounty hunting filled book I've ever done.
Well, I'm also excited about the book, because we have Nira X as part of the story, simply because of like a historical kind of angle to it, because Nira had her very first appearance in Zen number 0. So she wouldn't exist for me as a character that I could publish unless it was for Zen and Steve and Dan allowing me to write those books and allowing me to put in my own characters that I still use to this day.
Like, fantastic. Nira. Yeah,
I gotta be nice to Nira. She pays my rent.
SDA is asking, what happened after Nira X anime?
You know, the Nira X anime issue that we did, it was really a one shot. We did that with Entity Comics back in the day, and I did an issue of Nira X, but I kind of drew her, and I did the whole issue in a much more manga type style, because manga is a huge influence. So I just really pushed it all the way that way, and I just titled the book Nira X anime. But it was just a one shot. It's like, I really like her having some action adventures with her. She has a nemesis called Delta Void. He's like this big mechanical guy that gets bigger as he eats more metal, and he's got a bad attitude towards Nira for constantly kind of squashing his plans. So it was just a real fun escapist action adventure issue, like most Nira X issues actually are. It's just good escapist fun. I think she's actually aware. She's not breaking the fourth wall or anything, but I think she's aware that she's in a comic book subconsciously. So it's just good escapist action fun with a lot of humor, and that's what Nira is all about.
All right, man. Jeez. Ken's got a question here. Says, are there any plans for Zen to meet other cyber angels aside from Nira?
Not currently.
But we've got so much going on that that could be something on the back burner.
For anything that Nira does with Zen, there has to be a lot of coordination, because doing anything with Zen requires First Comics is a larger publisher. Nira is published just by myself or by Committed Comics, which is actually Tom Doherty's publishing arm. So the stories that we have through there are different and separated. You know, she kind of exists in her own universe. But I would like to see more stuff with Zen in the future, but it takes a lot of coordination.
Yeah, but you have to understand that Bounty Wars is going to take up this entire year and probably...
Oh, no, this 4-issue series. Yeah, this is...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, this is going to take up the rest of the year for sure. This will actually bleed in the next year, so...
Yeah.
Absolutely. And what's the timeline for the 4-issue series?
We're planning on fulfilling this campaign in July in time for San Diego Comic-Con. So right. I don't know if especially what I'd like to do is actually fulfill a little bit before July, you know, sometime in June. So that way in July we're actually promoting and talking up issue 2.
Right.
As far as the Kickstarter.
In conjunction with Comic-Con, right?
Yeah, I really want to line it up with Comic-Con, so that way we can show everybody some preview artwork and show everybody where the story is going next, and actually get the Kickstarter up and running for July. But the delivery date for all the books is set for July, and it just gives me a little bit of padding. We're actually getting a lot of help when it comes to fulfillment, because First Comics is giving us infrastructure,
right,
and they're actually handling the actual shipping, fulfillment, and printing. It's a heavy load for them to be doing that part for us. So we should be able to be right back at the studio and creating again.
Right, but basically, since there are 4 books, right, you see, you can't start, as you probably know, you can't start your next Kickstarter campaign until the previous one has been fulfilled. So when you look at the timelines, because we got to print the books, we got to fulfill them, and then you run the month-long campaign. So I've kind of figured that it's going to be by spring of next year when everything is done and fulfilled, because we got to do each one at a time. So this is like almost like a year-long campaign, which I think is great. I mean, you know, it's like getting a movie mounted in a year. That's the way I look at it.
So every few months we drop our new album.
Yeah.
Me and Steve drop our new rap album.
Yeah.
How many pages is this first issue?
It's a 24-page story.
Or 24. So there'll be a 100 page book by the time the four books play out. The 100 page story.
Mm-hmm. All right. Very nice. All right, guys, so there you have it, Zen Bounty Wars number one. And thank you, SDA, for putting up all those links in the chat there. Appreciate that. Rachel also says Bill must have been in his teens when he first worked on Zen.
I was kind of, sort of. Yeah, I was in my very early 20s when I first started working on Zen. We started doing everything, really, as far as getting into comics was in 91. Was when I first got my very first gig with Eclipse Comics. I was 21 at the time, and and just been going ever since. So I'm amazed that I'm still here. I'm grateful. So aren't thanks everybody.
Every day you get up and you're reasonably healthy. That's a good day. It's a good day.
Absolutely.
Right? Good day to draw comics.
Absolutely.
Right on.
Man, oh man. Thank you guys so much for being on here tonight. Really appreciate the conversation.
Thanks for having us, dude, for sure.
I loved it, Peter. If you ever want to invite us back, you know we'll be there. Thank you.
You got it. You got it. Everybody in the chat, thank you guys too. Great questions. Thank you guys for your comments. And thank you if you backed during the course of the show. True Believer, we know that you backed. If anybody else did as well, or if you're going to back later on, thank you guys as well. Appreciate that.
Thank you so much.
So before we do part ways, Steve, where can they find you?
Well, I'm very active on like Instagram, and my Instagram handle is Stern8506. I don't know how I got that, but I'm Stern8506. You can see all of my stuff on Instagram. And there's also a Zen Intergalactic Ninja group. It's got a few hundred people in it that's on Facebook. You just search Zen Intergalactic Ninja. And that's where you find me. And anything that we can do for the fans, if anybody needs to contact us, they can contact us through Instagram or Facebook, and we'll get back to you.
Fantastic. And Bill, where can they find you?
Everybody can find me at billmouse.com. I got it on my little name tag there, so that way it's just easy to see. I got the link to all my different socials there. I'm most active on my Facebook page. So if that's if you guys are on Facebook, that's where I usually am first, and that's it. I got a little online store there on my webpage and Instagram and all the I'm at all the places.
All right, fantastic.
We're all over the place.
Yeah. Oh man. Oh, I hear you. SDA says use the links. Yes, SDA's got all these great links here. Thank you, SDA tonight, Johnny on the spot.
Oh, that's nice. Thank you.
All over the place with everything you need to know. Scroll up. Got some more there too. But thank you guys so much. This was great. And I'm going to have you guys come back because I still have more questions, but we just don't have enough time.
Yeah,
we'll have to do a part two.
We'll do more deep dives.
But yeah. It's great to meet another awesome Long Island guy. Thank you for having us.
Likewise, man. Absolutely, Steve. Thank you, Bill. Thank you so much as well. Everybody in the chat, thank you. Before we go, again, I do want to remind you guys, we got a bunch of little closeouts happening on the Alterna site, March 31st. Make sure you go there. Make sure you check out what we've got. We got the Granite Beast figure. We've got advertising space. If you do want to get advertising space, advertise your comic, advertise your store, advertise your service, whatever it may be. Advertise it in the pages of our comics. We got very affordable advertising, full page, $25. And right now on Blood Realms campaign, 15 to 18, the premium spots, 20% off. So a back cover you can get for 80 instead of 100. An inside front cover you can get for $60 instead of $75, and an inside back cover you can get for $40 instead of $50. So thank you guys so much. Really appreciate y'all being here. I'll be back, let's see, tomorrow night. I'll be back tomorrow night at 10 o'clock Eastern. And I have a guest, but my calendar, I have a marker that's covering up the name right now. But I'll be back.
There you go.
I'll be back tomorrow night at 10 o'clock with somebody. I will be conversing with an individual tomorrow night, 10 o'clock Eastern. Hope to see you guys then. Until then, everybody have a great night and an even better tomorrow. I'll see you guys soon.
Thank you.
All right.